Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In my choice to develop my loving self question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentation, My Choice to Develop My Loving Self. Recorded on the 11th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
You're very subdued today. Does that mean you're reflective? What does it mean you're just exhausted? Doesn't it? It's interesting, isn't it? Like, the more information you get, while there's that emotional resistance there, you can feel it sort of gets to the point where it's just like, enough now. Like, I can't handle more now. It's like, stop. Does that mean we should make a 4-day course rather than a 6-day one?
No.
Huh? 6-day one it is. Well, that's good because I'd have to double up my courses. There's too much information already. All right. Well, now we come to My Choice to Develop My Loving Self Q&A. So this is your opportunity to ask some questions about the previous session. So if we can start over here with Janie and over here with Lani.
AJ, I don't understand what spending time developing my faith would look like. Can you give me any clues?
Good question. Yes, I would love to give you some assistance with that. So what are we talking about firstly? It's faith in whom? God. So if you can keep the mic with you, that way I can talk with you about it, Jenny, since you've asked the question.
God.
So it's faith in God that we're talking about. But it's not just faith in God, is it, that we need to have some faith in?
Faith in my connection to God or the possibility of developing a relationship with God.
So faith in relationship with God, yeah. Also, there's some other things that we need to have faith in here.
Faith in God's love for me.
So in the relationship, we're talking about love and truth, aren't we? God's love and God's truth in this case. Yes. What else do we need faith in?
Faith in my ability to...
In how I've been
achieve
created.
Achieve it. Yes, yeah. In how I've been created.
Yeah, being created, yeah.
He made me to be able to do it.
Correct. So how I've been created. Faith in your real self, in other words,
you're going to need.
So faith that you can be your real self and so forth, isn't it? Yeah. So first what we need to do, what I'm suggesting to you do with faith, is to write down all the areas. So what I'm doing here is writing down all the areas that I see that I don't have much faith in.
Yeah.
So the first part of developing an aspiration to have faith is to have an aspiration to be aware of all the areas where there is little faith. Does that make sense? So that's number one. Write down, document for yourself the areas where you have little faith. So after you've documented the areas where you have little faith, now what you can do is put in a loving plan or action to actually develop faith in those specific areas. Does that make sense? So over here I'll put in the procedure, if you like, to develop faith is firstly to write down all the areas where I don't have faith. So in other words, all areas where faith is lacking. That's number one. Okay, so I've written down, this is an example, I've written down some areas where my faith is lacking. Right? The second step would be to actually... put in some kind of plan or action, wouldn't it? Make some kind of plan or action which will help me develop faith in a specific area. So make an action plan and make sure, though, that it's loving and compassionate, remember, to yourself In other words, you know, you remember part of deconstructing this facade and everything was all about making sure that we have compassion for our facade, wasn't it? So we need to make sure everything we do is loving to self that we're planning here. So make an action plan in this area. So what I would first do is go, okay, my action plan is I've got to firstly deal with or address this issue of denial here, right? So obviously if I have no faith, there's a lot of denial that's going on. So part of dealing with the denial is writing down all the areas where you feel faith is lacking. That's starting to allow yourself to become aware of where faith is lacking, isn't it? Yep. So that's really beginning to address this denial. But also, we've got to now look at the emotions associated with the denial. You follow me? So now what this action plan has to be, okay, what action can I take to confront my emotional denial, to actually expose my denial of where I have a lack of faith? In other words, what are my reasons for having a lack of faith? All right, so my action plan, which is loving and compassionate, focuses on reasons for, in this case, the first step is reasons for denial. Right? So let's go across to one of these issues. So let's choose God, the issue of God. Why don't I want to have faith in God? Now, can you see part of that might be that I don't even believe in God?
Yes. That was the first thing, but I thought that was too easy.
Yeah.
You know, a get out.
Well,
course.
A lot of us don't believe in God, so not yet anyway, because we haven't felt God yet. So I don't believe in God. I can't feel God.
The fact that when we were children, we thought our parents were gods, and so okay. All those emotions.
I've got God substitutes, shall we call them? And I don't want to give them up.
No.
So be honest about. So here we're going to have to be. We need a number of tools now, don't we? We need truth. We're taking action. We need truth. It's use of our will. And the whole focus of it is why I don't want to get out in denial with regard to my lack of faith. And I feel about these things. Okay, so I go, okay, why don't I believe in God? You know, is that because I believe in evolution? Is it because I look at religion and, you know, that's a mess? You know, it's created a terrible mess in the planet. Why is it that I don't believe in a loving creator? Right.
I think it's about terror that, you know, everything that you would have to do to be your real self. I think that's what it's more like.
For many, it's going to be earning God's approval.
Yeah.
If I believe in a God, then I've got to get God's approval.
Huge.
Earning things from God. You know.
Yes.
It's a terrible feeling, right, that you have to say, what is he going to demand of me? If he's anything like my parents, it's going to be a lot, right?
Yeah.
So these are the reasons why I don't want to have faith in God. All right? So I've made an action plan, a loving, compassionate action plan, focused on feeling my emotions on the reasons, which are all emotional. So it's about feeling my emotions about what I really feel about why I don't want to have any faith in God. So you start with the negative, really, right? So as to why don't you want to have that faith. Right? So that's where you start. Then I would do the same as the action plan here, loving action plan, but now I'm focused on what do these beliefs that I've now identified here, these emotions that I've now identified here, tell me about my addictions, right? And here, so one of my addictions is I'm earning love, for example, and I don't want to give that up. So I think I'm going to have to earn God's love too. And here I can't feel God because I'm too busy just, you know, having my other addictions met, you know, like doing whatever I can to just meet addictions. Or I'm too busy having my relationship with my parents, and if I have a relationship with God, my relationship with my parents will probably suffer, let's face it, because they created my facade. it's probably going to suffer. And so I don't really want God. I really want my parents. And that's my addiction. My addiction is to have parents. Now, why do we want parents? Well, for a lot of us, it's because we're worried that we're not going to get looked after. You know, particularly when we're younger, we're worried that we're not going to be looked after, we're not going to be cared for, we're not going to have someone to run to with our problems and so forth and so forth. We've substituted the things we would do with God. We can do all those things with God, but we don't. We want someone who we can see face to face to do that with. Right? So they are all reasons. So what we're suggesting here is we're now examining our addictions for not having faith. Our addictions for not having faith. Does that make sense? Right. Now at the same time as these negative things, we can also start doing some positive things. And that the positive thing is I educate myself about what God's really like. So, for example, if I don't believe in God, I go, okay, where did everything come from then? Is it possible that things come by accident when it's so, like, there's so much design in everything? Is that ever possible by accident? So if I build a building and then, you know, 600 years later, the building's still there. So some buildings on the planet, they're still there after 3,000 or 4,000, 5,000 years, right? And then I tell myself, nobody built that. It just all got there somehow by itself. It just all evolved. Like the average person would look at a building and go, there's no way a building evolves, right? It didn't get there by itself. Now my body is more complex than the building. Is that not true? Mm. Building is just a block of, you know, rocks or whatever it is, put it together in a certain way. The body is completely different than that, and it's also alive. So if the building, a complex building, in fact a very simple building, had to have gotten there through some intelligent designer, then surely my body had to get there through some intelligent designer. Right? And this is where we can start confronting, through our logical reasoning and through our own personal education about what is actually scientifically true, we can start confronting our belief systems that we prefer to have as well at the same time. Now, I'm suggesting that our addictions and our denial prevent us from that confrontational process. So you have to deal with your addictions and denial before you'll start entering this confrontational process where you're really starting to confront the truth of the way the universe works. And now here I'm talking about the established truth as scientifically determined as truth. I'm not talking about what religions believe are true or, you know, what people who say they have faith believe is true. I'm talking about what is actually true. Right? So what is actually true is a building requires a designer. So if building requires a designer, then surely my body requires a designer. And a much more intelligent designer than the building required. Makes sense, doesn't it? Logically. And these are the kind of things we can analyse, right? From a logical perspective. And we only analyse the things that are established truths in that place. So that's a part of our education. We analyse what the truth is from an established point of view, and then we examine, well, what does that tell us about this God that probably exists? What does it tell us? Jenny?
How would you analyse if you didn't feel you were worthy of God's love and that it was hopeless to want it?
Well, you got logical analysis there. Would God create something and then offer something to that thing that he created when he felt that thing he created was not worthy? And if God created something that wasn't worthy, surely he would just destroy it.
So you have to be logical.
So you've got to be logical here in this analysis of your education and look at it from a logical perspective. But what I'm saying to you is denial and addictions cause you to not be logical.
Mm, exactly.
So this is why you've also got to address those issues.
Yeah.
There's emotional reasons to not accept logic.
Yes.
That need to be addressed. So we educate ourselves about God. And part of this education of ourselves about God is based on the truth of how the universe operates. So, for example, if a law is predictable, such as the law of gravity, how could that law have come about by chance? That's just a logical question, right? And we can ponder about that and think about that, allow ourselves to feel about that, whether it came about by chance. So this is still educating ourselves. We could start reading about what, you know, my suggestion is not to read religious things, because religious things don't have much faith in them at all. You've got to read scientific things, because the scientific things are where the truth is. Does that mean things? The things that have been proven to be true scientifically are where the truth is. Religious stuff is just like the meanderings many times of philosophical minds coming up with concepts and ideas that are often disproven by science. Right? Now, God is a scientist of the greatest kind and a mathematician of the greatest kind.
Absolutely.
And so therefore it makes sense that I study his work, which means studying mathematics and studying science. Does that make sense?
Yes, because I was thinking that I was just immediately going for the emotional one. But if you study God's ways with his laws and whatever, it gradually builds up truth so that when you come to the emotional stumbling block, you can use logic because you've...
Well, the logic, by studying the truth is built up in you and it causes you to now have some established faith.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But that's not the only thing that's going to give you faith. So you need to do this process. But the next thing I would then do is now starting to engage the education in terms of trying to communicate with God. So the fifth thing I would do, and I'm running out of space here, so...
do you want me to come and rub something off?
No, that's all right. Five is begin an experiment. This is the most important experiment of your life.
Yes.
So the most important experiment of your life is to begin experimenting with feeling God's feelings. Now, you can see that if I'm experimenting with feeling God's feelings, I'm probably also going to have to experiment with feeling my own, right? Otherwise, I'm going to be hopeless at feeling God's. But so I experiment with God. I experiment with feeling God's feelings. Now, once you get to a stage where, and now this is, you've got to be very careful with this experiment, by the way, feeling God's emotions. Because there are many spirits in the spirit world who believe themselves to be God. And if you are in addiction with them, they will come along and claim to be God and give you feelings. Right? So you've got to be very careful here that this is a pure feeling in you and not something that's driven by an addiction. So many of you have an addiction with God that you want God to come to your rescue, for example. So you're going to have to give that up. Now, you know that you've had that addiction with people. So it's highly likely you're going to have that. You try to have that addiction with God. Now it's not God that's going to step in under those circumstances. It's going to be a spirit that steps in and gives you that feeling. So you know that that's a problem. So what you would have to do is address that emotionally before you could undertake some safe experiments. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. So what you do is you experiment with feeling God's emotion, bearing in mind that God does not satisfy your addictions and God does not satisfy your denial. So this tells me that I am going to have to address these issues, and that's why I've put these up here. Action plan to address denial, action plan to address addictions. Right? That's why they're there, because I need that as a part of these experiments. But once I get down here, I'm starting to experiment, and in the process of the experimentation, you will occasionally feel something. And I say occasionally because the rest of the time you're probably in addiction of some kind. But there'll be times when you're in a pure space and you'll occasionally feel something. And what you do is you document that, because you're going to forget that. Right? You are. You're going to prefer to forget it, particularly when you hit here. When you hit the refusal of terror, you're going to prefer to forget that you had a faith-based experience with God. Because the terror is saying, don't go there, don't go there. And God's saying, go there. You're going to prefer to believe that God doesn't exist again, unless you document what's happened in the past and keep reminding yourself, reinforcing what you've done for yourself, right? But if you do those five things, you will build a faith in God.
Thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, there's many other things we could have said, of course, but these five things have helped me greatly develop a faith in God. Does that make sense? sense. Mm. And I feel they will help you a lot too to develop the same faith. Now, when you don't have sin, the big focus of developing faith in God is number four. Examining the scientific truth that's presented to you in the universe, and number five, experimenting with feeling God's emotion, are the two biggest things you can do. But you'd do that if you didn't have any sin. Right? So a person who's perfected in natural love but still does not believe in God would still need to engage some of this process, is what I'm suggesting, in order to develop faith in God. So there's many six-sphere spirits who have no faith in God, and they would have to do four and five. Right? Mostly. To develop some faith in God. Once they've experimented with feeling and they've educated themselves, now they can go back and look at some of their addictions that they've had to prevent them from seeing all these things and so forth. But a lot of times they've already dealt with a lot of their addictions. They already have a love for humanity and so forth. So they already are not feeding other people's addictions so much anymore and things like that. They know it's wrong to do that. They know it harms them when they do it, so they know it's wrong. So they've stopped doing a lot of these things that we naturally do here on Earth. And so they need to focus their attention on four and five. But if you focus attention on all those things on Earth, you will develop a faith in God. Now, I've found experimenting with scientific truth and mathematical truth to be one of the most effective ways of really finding the truth of God's existence, aside from the most effective way, which is to feel God. Mm. And the point of doing all this deconstruction process is to actually God. Remember, we said right at the beginning, was so that you could get to
know God.
Feel God.
Yes, feel God.
That's the point of it. And these things stop you from feeling God. So it makes sense that you're going to have to undo the things that stop you from feeling God as a part of developing some faith in God.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Makes sense?
Thank you. Yep. That was wonderful.
Yeah. Okay, if we go to Lani. Thanks.
You talk about sharing your real self.
Yep.
And that sounds fantastic to me.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah, but can we have an action plan for doing that?
Am I going to spend the rest of the Q&A doing action plans for you?
Well, just when you've been suppressed for so long, how do you sort of really get through that?
It's a good question, Lani. Just let me rub off this.
As quickly as possible.
No worries, I'll do that for you. I'm sure the left side of my body, which is where I've torn my muscle, is going to be helped by doing that.
Yeah, I meant for me to get through my suppression as quickly as possible.
rather than give you an action plan, right, because you need to learn how to develop your own, right? You do. That's a part of your will, the expression of your will. We've given you a whole heap of tools already, so it's just a matter now of putting those tools into action. So you can see for most things, the answer is going to be, okay, where am I in denial? You know, what emotions are causing my denial on this subject? What are my addictions on this subject? Where are my addictions? When do I get angry? What does that anger tell me? And then working my way down, am I experiencing the terror yet? No. Then I must be still in some addictions here. And allowing yourself to work yourself through the whole process. But I've now forgotten your question.
But how do you share your real self?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Okay. So sharing your real self. What's the dominant reason why you're not sharing your real self?
Fear of rejection.
This isn't it.
Yeah.
It's your fear of what the world will do when you're your real self, is it not? So if that's your dominant thing, can you see that doing this is automatically going to help you finish up getting to the stage where you're ready to share your real self?
Yeah.
In a lot of ways, we've already answered the question.
Yeah. I think I'm just really blocked to that.
The terror.
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course you are. And that's why you want me to make an action plan for you that doesn't involve this.
Yeah.
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 And am I going to be able to?
No.
Even? No. I'm not even able to, because there's no way that you're going to be able to circumvent this. And I've said that to you frequently in this presentation, haven't I? That this is the process that everyone's going to have to go through if they want to get to God. So my suggestion is, okay, remember many of our questions are driven by an avoidance of a certain thing. And this is an example of one question that's often driven by the avoidance of what the problem is. The problem is our terror of being ourselves, our global terror. Remember, in the course, we've already said how to undo that. It involves deconstructing your addictions, getting out of denial, deconstructing your addictions. It involves developing aspiration to feel terror, and it involves having faith, which we've just gone through, how to have faith. Does that make sense? How to develop faith. You do those things, you'll get to that point, and then it's a matter of making a decision, isn't it? A choice, an emotional choice, of course, to feel the terror itself and to work your way through it, which I said won't take very long. For the majority of you, probably less than a month if you did it every day, right? Won't take you very long. So the problem is the terror is terrifying, and so we think a month of it is unbearable. And so what we do instead is we store it for 10 years or 20 years or 50 years or in our entire life. Now that's a pretty unwise decision, given the fact that it's now in us, killing us, right? Because it's our terror and fears that kill us, really. They destroy our body, they destroy our life, they create a lot of our extra pain and our extra desire to sin. Was all created by that. So obviously it makes sense to have a month of pain of feeling terror rather than having years and years and years of avoiding it.
Yeah, because you can just go into stagnation, denial.
Yes. So then the question comes, how do I develop an aspiration to feel this terror? We've already gone through that. You've got to first develop an aspiration to even feel what's on top of it, keeping it down, keeping it suppressed. Once you released what's keeping it suppressed, the terror will be there. And then remember we talked about touching it, allowing yourself to touch it, allow yourself to become more sensitive to feeling it to the point where you have a will to feel it. And once you have a will to feel it, you'll go through a month of a bad month. You will. And the bad month is going to look bad to you, look bad to everyone around you, look bad for your life, look bad for your prospects and everything, but it'll only last a month. If you do it every day, it'll only last a while. And then when you're out of that, you'll feel like, you know, you won't remember Lani anymore. Really, that's how it'll feel. You'll feel like you're a different person now. You get courage and you can start feeling your false definition of love quite easily. Yeah, a lot of things will change in that place. So really the action plan, I suppose you could call it, for addressing being my real self is all about addressing the terror that I have about being my real self. In fact, you'll find most of the time, most of your questions will be about finding the opposite feeling, the opposing feeling. Right? Remember in this plan that I just drew up, I said to find the reason why you don't want to have faith.
Yeah.
The way you develop faith is first to find the reason why you don't want to have it. So the way you develop your real self is first to find the reason why you don't want to be your real self. Makes sense, right? And then develop some aspiration to be will be easier because you're not going having go through your terror to do it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Developing aspiration, we've already gone through. We went through it in the first group and we've been through it here. So you know how to do that. Yeah. If we go to Laura, thanks.
Every time you say addressing, like when you say this just needs to be addressed first,
mm-hmm.
Your definition of the context of the word address, is that when you've actually, on any given issue, addressed it, meaning released the pain so that no longer exists?
Yes, it always means that, my perspective is, it always means that the emotions that are governing that state are released. So, for example, if we look at addressing, if I use the term addressing our addictions, what I mean is we work through, firstly, getting out of denial about my addictions, getting into accepting my addictions, getting into desiring to deconstruct my addictions, working through the deconstruction process for my addictions, and getting to the point where now I have no or hardly any addictions and I'm starting to touch my terror. That is the process of addressing your addictions. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So every one of these processes is emotional. So if I say addressing my pain, what I'm really saying is you have to have gone through there, and got to there.
Yes, okay.
So when I say addressing my pain, I'm referring to not only just the pain, but everything above it. Because everything above it has to be deconstructed in order for the pain to be exposed.
So the intellectual awareness is not really even the first step. It's when the emotional process begins, that's when you're starting to address.
Well, no, anything. Remember I said in the deconstruction process, the intellectual awareness is the first step.
Oh, yes.
Because you're getting out of complete denial, complete unawareness, and now you're at least intellectually aware that something's wrong. And that's better than having no awareness.
Yeah, that's right.
That something's wrong. So the intellectual process is a part of the process of deconstruction. Of anything, right? And if you'll examine the deconstruction process that we led you to in 2014 in the first assistance group we gave down at Munkaroy, you can see that deconstruction process applies to every stage of your development.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It first begins with the intellectual process of deconstruction, which comes to a state of intellectual awareness, and then you go through the emotional process of deconstruction, which ends up with emotional awareness of God's truth. Right? And everything in between that applies to any of these things. Now, for many of you, you get a bit hung up on trying to understand that intellectually. If you focused on dealing with the emotions, you would understand that process almost as a part of your natural feeling. Do you know what I mean? It's like when I wrote that process down, I was writing a letter to people in 2005 or 6 or something, I can't remember when it was, and all I did was describe what I felt to be the process, because that's the process I've been through. Do you follow? And so when I've described to you the deconstruction process, this process of intellectual into the emotional block, the intellectual block of awarenesses which is a step-by-step process, and the emotional block of awareness, which is a step-by-step process, when I wrote them down, it's just like easy to write it all down because I already knew that that's what I've been through. So for many of you, what you've got to do is allow yourself to go through that process, and then it will solidify in you, well, this is the process that Jesus was talking to me about. The process, that's what I went through first. I had to do this first, and I had to do that first, and I had to do this first, and then I got to that point, and then look at that, the emotion started going, and once that kicked in, that's where I ended up. And you'll then understand the process. Does that make sense? By going through it. Yep.
So when you said to the gentleman the other day that the best course of action is to start horizontally before we go vertically, but in every single time we really want to address something, we will just go vertically and then keep going horizontally.
No. What I said to him still applies. To get out of denial, you have to go through a process which starts at intellectual awareness or intellectual denial and ends with emotional awareness. To get out of denial, that's what you have to do. And then now you're aware of what you're denying. And then to deal with your addictions, you're going to have to start with denial that you have any of them. And many of you have done that, right? Denied that you have any of them or felt they were all good. And then you start with intellectual denial, and then you go through the process and get right down to releasing the actual addiction emotionally, the justification for it, which actually releases the addiction itself, and now you're in a state of emotional awareness about that addiction. Does that make sense? And when you get down to the terror, you're going to start with complete denial, intellectual denial as well as emotional denial. Many of you are in that place of denying it completely. And then you're going to have to work through the intellectual awareness that it's there, that it must be there due to different things that you can see happening in your life. And then you'll get through down into the emotional awareness. And when you release it, you'll realize, wow, what a large effect that big promotion had on my life. Does that make sense? You'll have awareness, God's truth about that particular thing. The same time, when you get to these false beliefs, you'll go through them many times, one at a time, sometimes groups of them, depending upon whether it's a multiple event, single event, and what emotions you process. But at the end of the day, you've now started to get out of needing the intellectual process, because this is, you're now used to this intellectual process happening as an automatic thing. And so now you're focused on the emotions that deny it, and working way through to emotional, full emotional acceptance, God's truth about the matter. So that process is the same for every step. Does that make sense to you, Laura? So that doesn't contradict what I've said to Chris in any way. Right? Remember, when you go back over this and you listen to what I said to Chris, basically what I said is that you need to work through these steps before you're going to get to the next step. You are going to need to work through the previous step. And this step here is a critical step, because this step stops you from getting to a lot of things. So it's a critical step.
Yep. Thank you.
So no difference. But can I address what happens with you, Laura? You're so busy analysing everything I say intellectually that you don't get a lot of what I say. And this is because you are unwilling to feel the emotional process. So what I would do if I was you is look at why you are so dedicated to being unwilling to feel the emotions, and particularly the terror-based emotions and the addictions that you have. Why is it that you're not wanting to address the emotionally address why you have those particular issues? Because you're always looking for more information, and more information doesn't necessarily help you. Frequently it's driven by fear. You're trying to allay your fear, which is actually an addiction.
Yeah, I feel if I get more clarity than the terror.
You think that if you get more clarity, things will be better.
Yes, that's true.
And I'm saying to you, no, things will get better when you feel your emotion, including the emotion of needing more clarity.
Because when I don't know, it actually enhances the whole terror.
Exactly. And you need to allow that to occur. You need to admit to yourself you don't know, and allow the emotions associated with not knowing to occur. And what you're doing is you're asking more questions. You get a mountain of questions, and then you start getting confused about what you asked and what was answered and everything. And this is all helping you remain disconnected from the emotion.
Yeah, I see that addiction.
And you're doing it for a reason. And the reason is you don't want to feel the emotion.
Yeah.
And you're not identifying that as your reason. You think you're doing it because everything's not clear. Now, it's real clear to me,
yeah.
And I've spoken about a lot of these things to you for 6 years.
Yes.
So if it's not real clear to you, I would suggest that you don't want it to be clear. And to me, that's an addiction, not wanting it to be clear. You know, frequently we ask questions because we want a different answer. You follow? And frequently when it comes to emotions, you want a different answer than the answer I'm giving you. Because a lot of the answers I give you focus back onto your terror, and you don't want to go there. And all you're doing is circumventing this through the questioning. You'd be better off feeling how much you don't want to go there, and be honest about it, be truthful about it. That's a part of deconstructing this facade. Does that make sense? Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. If we go to Kate on this side straight. Yep, thanks.
I was just thinking about what you were mentioning with Jane about experimenting with feeling God's feelings.
Yes. So when we talked about the faith issue that
yes,
we discussed. Yes,
as part of that, yeah.
Yep.
So when we are sincere in that,
yep.
Is God's willing to do it with us even when we're in the still in facade?
Well, no, God's not going to respond to our addictions.
No,
and He's not going to respond to our desire to avoid pain. So if we're trying to get a relationship with God for those two reasons, then of course God can't respond to that. That's why I said, remember in the first two steps, we had to do an action plan about our denial, an action plan about our addictions. Yeah.
So, yeah, I was just thinking whether I could use that to help with the accepting facade stage,
Well, I feel you can do it for you every process, pretty much.
But maybe that's why this should be the first one. You're encouraging us to look at with God first.
Well, the beauty of focusing on your stuff with God first is that as you work your way through the stuff with God, everything else gets drawn apart, like pulled apart. It does. You expose a lot of things. But if you refuse to focus on your stuff with God, then you're only going to do what you're motivated to do other than that. So what I notice many of you doing is this. Your main reason for hearing divine truth has not been to have a relationship with God. Can you feel that for many of you? Your main reason for listening was all about what? Right, so let's call it bluntly fixing self, shall we? And not even necessarily self, it's fixing life. And a lot of times that meant fixing other people so that I could have a happy life, right? And what are the motivations have we had? In particular, it's been fixing my primary relationship, isn't it? Partner relationship. That are the main motivations for most people who first listen to God's truth. Now, we've talked about that before, many times, in fact. In fact, I had a discussion, I think it was in 2014 or 13, about the emotional process, and that one whole discussion for 4 hours was about focusing our attention. The thing that drew us to divine truth was the thing about really, really selfish, quite selfish motivation. So we haven't been motivated, and we've got to be honest about it, we haven't been motivated by becoming a loving person and having a relationship with God in order to become a more loving person. We haven't been motivated by those motives. We've been motivated by more selfish purposes and reasons. And many of you still sitting in this audience are motivated only by those things. Now, what I'm suggesting to you is, and this is what we've suggested right from the beginning, the problem with those things is you won't get an education in love from God. And as I've said to you, right from the beginning, your happiness will depend greatly on whether you're getting an education in God's love or whether you're going to continue your education in what humans define as love. Do you follow? So my feelings are, Kate, a lot of the times where we need to be, this is why I feel we need to focus our attention on our relationship with God to a much greater degree. What I have personally found is that if you focus your attention on God's love first and on the relationship with God first, it pulls you through all other addictions and dependencies. Whereas if you focus on fixing your partner relationship, for example, or just fixing your life, once you determine your life to be happy, you'll stop. Or once you determine that your relationship is now better and more satisfactory, you'll stop. You won't keep going because there's no motivation to keep going. And what I'm suggesting to you is that unless you put God first, and this is what we're going to be talking about in our next presentation, actually, our priorities. Unless we put God first in solving our problems with God first, then what happens is that we are not drawn to fix everything else. What we'll finish up doing is only fixing the thing to our personal satisfaction. Now, as I've mentioned to you also, the problem with that is that God has a much greater desire for your happiness than you have for your own happiness at this stage. So what I'm saying is that God wants you to be much, much happier than you yourselves at this point in time feel you're capable of even being. So unless I focus my development with God, I am never going to experience the happiness God designed me to experience. I'm only ever going to experience the happiness that I think I'm capable of right now. Right. And so that's why it's so important to focus this primarily, like focus this deconstruction of your facade and into your pain with God, the stuff you've got going on with God first, because if you do that, it'll draw you through every other thing, and on top of that, it will result in you being more happy than you could ever currently imagine yourself to be. Like when I first started this process myself in this life, I had a feeling that if I could just survive this life, I'd be happy. Because I felt like I probably wasn't going to survive it if I kept going the way I was going. And that's the feeling that drove me. And then after a while, I realized, after about a year of my own progression doing that, I realized that wasn't a very good aspiration. Right? I realized the better aspiration would be my aspiration was that I would be happy while I'm living this life, not just surviving it. Right? That would be a better aspiration. So I began to have that aspiration. Right? And that drew me through many more things than the first aspiration would have ever done. And then, after a while, I realized, no, I want my relationship with God back. Right? Now that drew me through a lot of stuff that I would never have dealt with if I'd just had a desire to be happy, my conception of happiness. Right? Now once you've got that desire happening with God, now fixing self is going to be an automatic thing that happens, because once you've fixed your relationship with God, yourself is already fixed. Right? Fixing your life, well, once you've got a relationship with God to a point of atonement, your life is fixed too. Right? There's no more pain in your life, no more sin, therefore no more pain in your life, so your life's fixed. Fixing your relationships, well, once you're at one with God, you're happy in any relationship, even if you have none. Right? So that's fixed too. Everything gets fixed. Right? So that's why it's so good to focus your attention on firstly these issues with God and any issue that interferes with that relationship as a number one priority. Now, for most of us, that's not our priority. Our number one priority is usually one of these things. And for many of us, our number one priority is self, 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 partner. Or partner, 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 maybe self. And then, you know what I mean? You know, our priorities are like severely distorted. And that's one of the reasons why we struggle to be our loving self. So that's what I suggest. Yeah. Focus on that with God and it will help you greatly in every other aspect of your life. Whenever God's not communicating with you, there's always a reason, because God wants to communicate with you. So there's always a reason. And what I like about it is there's always a reason that's inside you. See, when your partner's not talking to you, well, it could be because of something you did, or it could be something because of their problem, couldn't it? Could be either, and you don't really know. But when God's not talking to you, you know that it's something inside of you. And that is always great, because now I don't have to worry about the other person in the relationship and what they're going through to assess the situation. All I've got to do is focus my attention on myself and how I see myself and how that situation is addressed. So that's much more powerful for me. I can change myself. I can fix that through these processes that we've been through. Yeah. Now, of course, we've only shared with you part of the information. Because remember, this is an 8-group program. And remember, group 3 is about law, and group 4 is about sin, understanding sin, and group 5 is about removing it. Group 6 is about engaging God's laws. Group 7 is more about the relationship with God specifically and receiving God's love. Group 8 is all about loving God. Like, so don't forget that this is only a part of the information. But if you engage it, by the time you get to group 3, understanding laws, you'll understand them. And by the time you get to, you know, understanding sin, you go, I get it, right? Because of what you've already been through emotionally, you get it. And when it comes to removing sin and repentance and concepts of repentance and forgiveness, you'll get that because you've already been through the emotional blockages and released all of that that stopped you from getting that. And that's why we've designed the program the way we have. Yeah. Okay, now what's my time like here? I should finish at 1:10 and it's 1:08. So I reckon I can have one more question, but knowing me, it's probably going to go for 10 minutes. If we go to Nikki up the back, thanks. Thanks, Nikki.
Okay, when you say we could go into terror for like a month, You don't mean every minute of the month.
Yeah, pretty much.
For a whole month. So we'll be.
You might have 5 or 6 hours of it at the first day, and you know, but you still feel pretty terrified the rest of the time. And but 5 or 6 hours intense where you can't do anything, can't work, can't do anything. Mm-hmm. And then the next day it might be 4 hours, the next day it might be 2 hours, but it might go on like that for a month.
Can we control when we go in and out of it?
No. Okay. My suggestion is if you work, get some holidays built up, ready for it.
That's something.
You obviously, when it's going to happen is firstly when you've deconstructed a lot of your facade, so you're touching the terror emotionally, and then also deconstructed any blockages to actually going through the process, the feeling of it. So once that's happened and your will's developed to feel it, you'll start feeling it and you'll have to make some pretty quick decisions. Mm. You will have to make some pretty good decisions about the next month and what you're going to do.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. Thanks.
So build up that long service leave, or build up whatever it is, whatever the sick leave or whatever it is that you need, because you're going to need it, and you're going to need to go through the process at some point. The key is to go through the deconstruction process. If you're sincere going through the deconstruction process, it might take you 3 years. So for many of you, you're 3 years away from probably feeling any terror. Right? If you're sincere. If you're not sincere, it'll take longer, of course. Right? Going through the terror might take you a month. Going through the pain, well, I've been working on my pain now since I dealt with my terror. My pain has been going 17 years. But it's a lot easier in the sense that, like, once you've dealt with terror, you can deal with anything, right? So it's a lot easier. And you'll have less than I, because I've had 2,000 years of memories to address through the emotional experience of my current parents. And so, you know, you've only got your current life to address. So your current pain is actually worse than any pain that you're going to have to address. So I suggest it will only take a few years if you're sincere. But you know, requires sincerity every time. Yeah. So, but this is the time when you're going to need to be prepared for it coming upon you. But it's not going to come upon you for many years yet, because there's quite a big, you know, monster there, right? Isn't there? You know, constructed facade, and you're yet to fully use all the things we talked about today in my choice to developing my loving self, to the tools in an appropriate way to deconstruct it. So, you know, there's things to learn here. There's a lot to learn before you'll probably hit this terror itself as an emotion and have to experience it. Right? Now, for some of you, you're closer than others because you might have done a bit more work in your facade, or you have less of a facade, so it's always there. Some others will have a bigger facade and therefore take longer. It's not a competition. It's not a competition, it's a process, an essential process. So I would suggest, rather than worrying about what's ahead, Nikki, worry about the fact that you're yet to actually accept your facade and go through that, accepting it, you know, having some love for it and understanding where it came from and all those things. Do that. Don't worry about, you know, something that's like years ahead of you. Worry about the thing that you need to do right now, right? So, and this is what I notice many of you doing. You go, okay, AJ's now informed us about what we're going to have to do. He's given me some examples from his own life about what he's have to do. It looks pretty bad, so I don't even know if I want to start. But there's a huge amount of blessings that come from having a relationship with God, knowing God's truth, having it firmly fixed in your heart. Huge amount of blessings. You're not going to experience those blessings unless you start and get the process underway. So if you're in denial, work through your reasons why you're in denial. If you're in your addictions a lot and you're in the facade a lot, work through all of these addictions and work through your justifications of them. They cause further pain, further sin. You need to undo them. Stop worrying about this, because most of you are worried about this. And why are you worried about it? You're not even there yet. Like in the first century, I said, sufficient for each day is its own anxiety. In other words, if you're worried about something happening tomorrow, you're already thinking too far ahead. You are. It's very rare for Mary and I to be concerned about anything we're doing tomorrow. The only time we do it is when we involve other people in our plans. That's the only time we're concerned about tomorrow. The rest of the time, we're focused on what's happening today. That's what I suggest you do. Plan your life so that you can live your life that way, where you focus on only what's happening today. Because it's what's happening today that you can change. Not what's happening tomorrow. You don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow. What's the point of trying to change that? Right? Do what you need to do today. Now, that doesn't mean you wouldn't make loving plans for maybe 6 months' time or a loving action plan about what you're going to do. But focus on today. What is it today that you're doing to fix this problem? So if this is 3 years away and you're asking questions about that, that tells me you're too worried about that and not worried enough about today. And what's going on today? And what's going on today is that Nikki hasn't accepted her facade. That's what's going on today. That's what Nikki needs to let herself do. Develop a desire to do, an aspiration to do. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, well, that brings us to the close of our Q&A. Thanks for your time there, guys. And thank you. So we will have an hour's break, which will bring us to quarter to two. Half an hour. Quarter to two. And then we've got two more presentations and we'll send you packing. Send you home after that.